announcements. The Vita change for this month is to help replace a garbage disposal in the kitchen. And we put out in the newsletter that we need additional volunteers to assist around the church with some different cleaning tasks, whether it's help clean up in the kitchen, whether mopping and cleaning the fellowship hall floor, some of the weeding around the church, the perimeter of the building, and so on. So if you're interested in volunteering and want to bring a couple friends with you, that'd be great. Call the office, talk to Jane, and let her know that you're interested in assisting, and we've got plenty of tasks for everybody, so nobody can be left out. Well, please prepare for worship.
Good morning. I'm going to interrupt your preparing for worship. I need to let you all know of a couple of things that have gone on this past week. On Thursday of this past week, Jose Sandoval, who is Dina's husband, passed away. Jose was, I think, 104. And he was a World War II vet. And although he is Roman Catholic, he would join us occasionally. Also, this past week, after a pretty sudden illness, Sam Oscar passed away. The Oscars and the Sandovals, I would ask that you keep them in your prayers. As we prepare for worship with the prayer this morning, I would ask that you keep those two families in your prayers. Remember those loved ones of yours that have gone before you, and remember all saints together as we prepare. Now we can prepare for worship. Through our city, through our hearts, through rescued Noah and his family from the flood. You opened wide the sea for the Israelites, and now in these waters you flood us with mercy, and our sin is drowned forever. You open the gates of righteousness, and we pass safely through. In Jesus Christ you calm the troubled waters. You nourish us and enclose us in safety. You call us forth and you send us out. In lush and barren places you are with us, and you have become our salvation. Now breathe upon this water and awaken your church once more. Claim us again as your beloved and holy people. Quench our thirst, cleanse our hearts, wipe away every tear. To you, our beginning and our end, our shepherd and our lamb, be honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. God our Creator, the resurrection of your Son offers life to all the people of earth. By your Holy Spirit, kindle in us the fire of your love, empowering our lives for service and our tongues for praise. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord, who lives and who reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Leisure, pleasure, you can say these words and you can hear them said in different ways. We say these things out loud differently. C-O-K-E. Do you say pop or soda? I would like to think with you about language for the next few minutes. I believe you and I were called by the Holy Spirit to gather in this place this morning to celebrate Pentecost together, the sending, the giving of the Holy Spirit. And I believe the Holy Spirit is who calls us to gather in this place, and that it gives us an identity as the people of God. This is who we are. This is where we're rooted. We are children of God. But I think there's this whole other way to express that. We know what our identity is, but our language could kind of go different directions. The way we can voice who we are can be complicated. Communication can be complicated. And that's what I would like to think about with you for the next few minutes. I have two teenagers that live in my house, and they say things all the time that send me to Google Translate to figure out what it is that they're talking about. That is so cap, bro. That is so cap, bro. That's a new one. Do you know what this is? That is so cap. It's obvious. If that's fake. Like, if the word cap means it's fake, that's a lie. That's untrue. So if it's cap, it is not true. Do you know that? I didn't either. I had to go figure this out. And when my kids say it, I have to go over, like, should they be saying it, or that sort of thing. Sus, do you know what sus is? We live in a digital age, and part of the way that the technology has changed the way we speak is that it's shortened words down. And it's cut the back end of them off where it came in because it's easier to text. Sus is suspect. That's sus. And in a world where anybody can say or post anything and it looks the same, it's, you know, it's news, it's on the web, and it's the same sort of places, it's important that people be able to say, well, that seems sus. And my kids would say, that seems sus, I'm not sure about that. Lately, my youngest son has taken to saying he's a menace. How do you feel about that? I'm a menace, he'll say. I'm not a fan of him saying that. I'm a menace. But apparently menace means like savage or good at what you apply yourself to, and he thinks this is a good thing. I do not think being a menace sounds good, but I need to Google Translate these things sometimes. I would like to think with you all, the people of God, gathered here by the Holy Spirit, about what our identity is. That we're rooted in a tradition, we're rooted in who God calls us. I also want to think about a sort of openness to a world that speaks, maybe communicates in a whole different way. I also want to think about how maybe communication is such a sort of broken and frustrating thing these days. When my sons speak this way, that's kind of frustrating, it's kind of annoying. I don't really know what they're saying, but I have to figure that out. And I know that we're rooted in the Holy Spirit, but the world speaks differently. And this is a little bit of what we think about on Pentecost. Our identity in the Holy Spirit, but the idea of languages and the idea of how we communicate who we are and how that expresses itself in the world around us. Technology has changed our way of speaking. It has changed language. I think my habit is to believe that language is set, that it's established, and that what you say, what you communicate, and what you say with a word is set. But I'm beginning to learn more and more that it's a dynamic, changing thing, and that it maybe changes more now than it ever has. And that puts us in this position where thinking about our identity is one thing. We're children of God, we're called by the Holy Spirit, but we're open to the way the Spirit is at work in the world around us. And so we are established, but we think about language as this way to interact with people. Do you notice how much technology has changed the language. What's a cloud? How would you explain what a cloud is? It's just that thing where all my stuff goes, but it's, you know, the thing in the sky, too. To me, do you all know what a pen is? A pen is that has ink and you write things with it? Do you remember what a pen is? To me, a tablet is a bound set of paper that I use my pen to write with. But is that all that a tablet is? Language has changed. What does it mean for something to go viral? Somebody's sick. I don't know, but it means that something has really spread to a lot of people. Technology has changed our language. And you and I are called to this place. We're reminded that the Holy Spirit is who calls us. And the Holy Spirit is God giving us our identity, children of God, washed in the waters of baptism. But we also live in the middle of a world that speaks and uses language in an ever-changing way. And so this is what I would like to share with you about this morning. The first reading for today, which was not read, but which is printed in the bulletins, comes from the 11th chapter of Genesis. And it's a story that you all probably know or have heard at some time or other. Have you heard the story, the idea of the Tower of Babel? You heard that story before. It's an Old Testament story. It's people coming together, building a tower to heaven, and it's the way that that plan works out. Just recently, not far from where I live, they're in the process of building, and have just finished a new cell phone tower. You've driven and seen cell phone towers all over the place. And I couldn't help but drive past this the other day and think about the Tower of Babel and think of how this tower is building its way higher and higher every day, and how it's supposed to help our communication and how it's supposed to help us come together. But it seems like communication, the way that we speak, is more complicated and more divided and more broken than ever. I believe that humans remain the same. I believe underneath all of this, we hold a lot in common with each other, with the people that we meet, that God has created us the way that we are. But in the world that we live in, with how fast it's getting, with how open language is, with the way people speak, we sometimes get away from what connects us. And we get into this place where our communication, where our words, it's like me speaking to a teenager. It's just sort of head scratching. It's the way that we express ourselves. And so I would like to think about this. I believe that you and I are rooted. I believe when the Holy Spirit calls us into this place and we gather here, we're rooted in a position, a history, a story of God at work in the world around us. I think sometimes the world could use that rootedness a little bit more. But we live in a world where communication seems to have broken down. Who are we? What is our identity? And how do we speak? This is the question, the idea of Pentecost. We're rooted. We have our own words and our own language. Do you know what the word narthex means? Do you know the word narthex? Does this word ring a bell? Where is it north of narthex? We know what this is. We're rooted. Do you know what the sanctuary is? We've gathered into the sanctuary. While our language would use the word sanctuary in one way, our world uses the word sanctuary in many different ways. Are you aware of what the word nave means? Nave, N-A-V-E. It sort of rings a bell, like it's sort of a word that you know, it's sort of a word we're rooted in, but it maybe is harder to remember. Nave tends to be the part of a sanctuary where people gather. The nave is where we sit. And it is separated from the chancel, so by a step, by a rail, and these are some rooted words. words that have a tradition, that have a meaning to us, and these are the words that we're rooted in, that in our chancel is a table, and this place we gather around word and sacrament, and we're rooted in an identity in these things. We're told that God makes us in these things, in word and sacrament, but is this a language that all the people driving by speak in? Are these words that people know? Are these words that people can hear and hear who God is in? You and I are rooted. God's Holy Spirit calls us, and it gathers us into this place, and it feeds us into the tradition of Jose Sandoval, Sam Osgood, and all of the saints, and we share an identity and a history and a story, and we do so because in it we're reminded of the depth and the longevity and the meaningfulness of God's love for us. But one of the hardest things is that who we are and what we're rooted in, what our souls are, and the language of the world that we live in are kind of separate and different. I like to think about this with you, about the challenge of language. You don't necessarily have to agree with me, but my sense is that people are still people, and that one of the biggest sort of issues or obstacles or hardest things that we have is that communicating who we are and connecting our soul, our call, our sense of rootedness in the spirit with others, because languages move around or change so much, can be hard to do. But really, that while our towers of the devil get built, cell phone towers, communication has gotten harder. I don't even have an identity, but communication seems to be difficult. I want to think about this. This past week, in driving past the cell phone tower going up and thinking about language and hearing my boys say words that have come in minutes that I don't know how I feel about, I've been thinking about this. I thought about it, and I thought about the history of our ancestors and the history of people of faith, and for whatever reason, this idea sort of popped into my head that I want to think about. Today's gospel reading, we're asked, or we're called as people of the Holy Spirit to be made one and set in the midst of the world for the benefit of God's presence. That we're made one, we're filled with the Holy Spirit, and that God leads us as the people of God in the midst of this world of all of this sort of broken communication, so that we can share and offer God's love and presence in the world we live in. This is the idea of Pentecost. And one of the words that's buried in there is the word commandments. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And I thought about this. I thought about the people of Israel and the Ten Commandments. But today's late service will celebrate the affirmation, baptism, and confirmation. The three students here, and part of that involves their having been taught the Ten Commandments, and we celebrate that as part of their confirmation. Have you ever thought about the Ten Commandments and how they came to us? The people of Israel were in captivity in Egypt, an established place, a place with its own language and its own sort of set, established language, and everything was sort of put together. And it wasn't until God called the Israelites out of set and into this sort of dynamic, changing, crazy place of the wilderness that the words, the language of the Ten Commandments were given. So I'll say that again, I've been thinking about this. That we're rooted people. That we're called by the Holy Spirit, and we're given an identity. I've been thinking about the story of the Israelites who lived in one set place, whose days were routine, and they knew them, and they knew the language. God called them to be set free, and they left the place that was established and known, and they were called out into the desert. And it wasn't until they were into the desert where everything that used to be set was sort of wiped away that they were given this beautiful new language. The language of the Ten Commandments and the language of how God calls us to live and be in the world. So I've been thinking about that. We're certainly established people. We certainly have been called by the Holy Spirit and gathered in this place and reminded that we are part of the history of all the saints and that God is at work in us. And this is our identity. And it roots us and it grounds us and it gives us a place that the child of God cannot be taken from us or changed. And this is who we are. But we're sort of in the wilderness at this point. The way people communicate is crazy. I am not trying to be capped here. What I'm saying, I'm not trying to sound sus. And the last thing I want to do is menace you all. But I believe that we are rooted in who God has called us. Child of God, people of God, and that this cannot be taken from us. And if we are in the wilderness and communication is so difficult, our identity is still our identity. But openness, that openness to the Holy Spirit, that openness to speaking and being and finding God in the world that has changed and is at odds is a sometimes scary place, but it also can be the place of new life and hearing God's voice anew. We are in a time when communication is supposed to be easier. I spent 2 hours this week with a bank that wanted me to sign something digitally and couldn't get the document to me. And I kept saying, it would be quicker for me to drive in. Oh, we can't do that because the other person already signed this digitally. It must be digital. Do I have your email and your phone right? You're talking to me on my phone. You have it right. And I spent 2 hours with them on this. And this seems like the way that communication is supposed to be so much easier. In the midst of that, who we are and what we're rooted in does not change. God's love for us is the same. Our baptism, our gathering around the Word and this meal roots us and tells us what our identity is. Language might shift all around us. The way people speak or misspeak or miscommunicate might be all sort of mixed up, and that might be frustrating or annoying. But I believe that our identity remains our identity. And that if this is the wilderness where you can talk to banks for 2 hours just to digitally sign something, which I still haven't done, by the way, I still haven't gotten to. I believe that we have already all that we need, a rootedness, an identity, and that our language, our communication with others, and openness to where God might be at work in the midst of all of this, could be a renewing thing. It could be renewing for other people who need to hear how God is at work. And it can be renewing for you and I. It was in the wilderness, a time when language and routine was wiped out, that God gave the people of Israel the beautiful language of the Ten Commandments, a language that stays with us and forms us. Maybe that language is so broken down scares us, but maybe it's also a place for us to find new ways to communicate who we are and what our identity is with others. We're rooted in God's call. joy-filled, resurrected new love. Amen.
Thank you. this is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ. It's given for you. This is the body of Christ. It's given for you. This is the body of Christ. It's given for you. This is the body of Christ. It's given for you. This is the body of Christ. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the body of Christ.
This is the body of Christ.